I'm Marlika, and I work at the Kennisland. Kennisland is a think and do tank for social change in the Netherlands. We're 16 years old, and we're independent and non-for-profit, and we work with 20 people, and we've finished about 140 projects, and we have about 20 projects running still. Kennisland really works in the fields of governance and education, and also on research and cultural heritage and opening up our cultural copyrights. So before I go into the project that I really want to talk about today, which is Feed Forward Stories, it is a social lab methodology. I would like to tell you a little bit more about our own assumptions on change and our own beliefs on why we need this kind of change. And there are three things sticking out. One is that we believe that we live in a world that is shifting from being about producing content in very small, powerful nodes to really shifting to a world where we really need to work with very contextual settings. This really means a lot for the way we transfer knowledge. This means we possibly do not need to work so much anymore on transferring knowledge from one person to another, but really see if we can collaborate and make knowledge together in contextual settings. This means a lot for our education and also in the way we do research and in academic settings. Second one is that we see, but also a lot of other researchers and politicians have been talking about, is that we see a rise of inequality in our world. There is money accumulating in one place, and there's an increasing amount. People are not becoming more poor, but the inequality is really on the rise. This means a lot for how we think about networks and how networks can be disconnected in cities and also in countries and in the world. A third one is we see that experts and academic experts and policy experts really are losing ground in a way that there are a lot of laymen in very wise crowds, and we can all become an expert these days in our own way. These are three really interesting developments that mean quite a bit for the projects that we run. So here's where Kieran probably left off. we also have a project. We are a think tank, but we have think tents all over Holland and also in Europe. And this is one of my projects in the city of Nijmegen. It's in the east of Netherlands. And you can see that there are a lot of disconnected stories and networks in this city. I can see the orange ones are the youth. This is a project about youth and how you can live well as a young person in the city, but also how you could be doing better. And you can see there are a lot of great, good intentions floating around in the city. So we can see the orange talk balloons are the youth, and I start from the left up. It says Alex, and he says, when you are fucked up, you meet fucked up people. He just got off a cocaine habit, and he really wants to find a job, but he's really not finding a job. He finds it super hard to find a job. And the statement really stuck out, like, when you are fucked up, you meet fucked up people. And this is really going on in Nijmegen and probably also in quite a few other places. This is also maybe resembling to us, like we in this room are really doing quite well. We might be coming from hard places, but right now, we are doing quite well, and there are not so many people in this room who are not doing right well. They are outside here in the neighborhood. That's also what I'm going to do in the workshop this afternoon, is that we are going to add some new photos and stories from talking about the humans of Berlin wedding. So if you want to join that, it'll be great. Nino, he says, I worry so much about my debts, it clouds my brain. I cannot think anymore, and I really want to think, and I want to go back to school, but I don't know how. But then are in the system, people who try to support them, they are also disconnected. So here's Oliver, he's an academic at the University of Nijmegen. I finished my research, but for some reason no one engaged with the results in the municipality. You know? And then there's Mustafa, he's a youth worker. I really want to help Alex, but I'm stuck in the bureaucratic rules. And there's Linda, a policymaker. I don't really meet youth myself, but the best work days are when I do. So you really wonder, like, what's going on in the city? So yeah, there's young lives on the outside. There's a support system on the other side. But they really work different too. These boys talk in the park all day and they make knowledge. And on the right side, there's the policymakers. They also make knowledge in the project room for transitions, for youth help and new laws. So it's really different. So how to connect these stories and how to connect these networks? How to also really work together. So this young boy on the left with his skateboard, yeah, he really works different and thinks about things different and really wants to connect with his skateboard. While on the other side, the municipality and the aldermen, that is how they work in the in their rooms. So can we try something out together? These are some ideas that come out of the methodology that we use. What if there was a ministry of open networks instead of a ministry for work and employment? What if there was a ministry for demolition in terms of, like, can we really get rid of some things that we don't need anymore? Why always build on the system and the system? What if there was a police force for inclusion and exclusion? I mean, there's always a police force for, you know, doing things not right, but can we also have a police force that's walking around in the city looking for inclusion and exclusion? And what if there were more cooperative citizen universities? So here at Kennesland, we have developed a methodology called Feed Forward Stories, and it is really helping academics and policymakers, citizens, professionals, to connect together and work around a very quite simple methodology for bringing citizens on the left and institutions or systems and support systems on the right, bring them together in four steps. We have developed this methodology in Amsterdam in a prototype week for 2 weeks with the municipality, and then went on to develop it on in Dordrecht, Nijmegen, Schiedam. And we have just started our first sort of lab school or social lab school in Hong Kong. What does this look like? So you start at the left bottom by creating a social lab setting. This means you build a very multidisciplinary team. You get the professionals, the youth policymakers, the academics, also artists, entrepreneurs, students, anyone I can get in my team, I try. So I have now 16 people working in the team in Nijmegen, and I'm the facilitator of the process, together with my colleague from Kennesland. We find an open office in the field, so we try to find a space that is of no one, so that we can meet in a more neutral way, or we are not stuck in the work cultures that we know. Then we get acquainted with the local context and we formulate an open research question. And to go quickly through this process is, on the left, we first start with collecting, interpreting, checking and publishing stories with citizens. We publish them all on an open blog. This means that all of our research data is open throughout the complete process. So anyone can read the blog and can then pitch in with their own ideas. And we tweet about it, of course. Then we collect 15 to 20 stories from citizens mainly, so in this case youth, only from citizens. So we roam out in the city and we find people in the park, on the street, in the shisha lounge. And the second part is we try to then chase those stories into the system. So in these stories of citizens, people mention pain points, people mention chances, people mention organizations like the municipality, the debt cancellation, the schools, but also sports school or something else. We go with these stories to the system and say, hey, can you give us a countering story on these problems? And tell us what your intentions are and your ways of working. That's the second one. Then we bring all these people together after 3 months, of everyone we talk to, all of the organizations that we gathered. And we generate collaborations over red threading themes. There are 5 policy themes now in Nijmegen coming out. 5 ways of sort of like red threading themes. It's called Inside Out, an open network, open politics, a strengthening between youth work and education, and an own status in the city, because there's also a lot of refugees coming to Nijmegen now. What if, how can you have a social status in a city when you don't have a status? So what does feel forward stories really deliver? I know we're always looking for evidence. First of all, we are really trying to connect lives and systems over really a lot of conflicts, because we don't find it easy to connect people, and also over collaboration. The second one is it really delivers research and action for local government and organizations, so basically for the systems. And the third one, it really delivers new action perspectives for people. There are five chances that are now coming forward around youth in Nijmegen. Making policy, gathering knowledge, another role of the local government, and other ways of communicating findings, and other ways of learning together. So I just want to quickly show you how it looks like in the field. This is our open multidisciplinary team gathering over a table in the neighborhood. And it consists of teachers, students, citizens, civil servants. This is our outside open office in Hong Kong, where we were talking to homeless people here. And we've been really out on the street a lot and asking open questions. And open question is a really difficult thing. How is it to be young in Nijmegen? What can I learn from you? Is it a really different question than a municipality question, which was about, we have a program about unemployment. How can we sell it to youth? We do a lot of collaborative knowledge production, meaning that the people that we work with make the knowledge and film and write their own stories. And the stories really lead to ideas for action. Then we deal a lot with power dynamics by setting up a reflection network. So that means we get the aldermen, the politicians, a lot of high-end managers in a reflection team, because they don't have to find the time to really engage with this process for 6 months. But we do really want to have these high-end positions in place. Scouting citizens means that you go to Shisha Lounge and smoke some whatever. And you collect the stories and check the stories with this guy, for example, on the left. He was deaf, so we were really trying to find some ways to communicate in a good way. And we published the stories on Medium blogs on the right. Furthermore, we do collective analysis and networking. This means that we put up the stories all together on the wall, two or three moments throughout the process, and really get everyone together to work around those stories to find new ideas for public prototyping. This is one prototype that we have developed in this process already. It's an infographic to show how policies in municipalities is made. It was so funny, we found out that no one really knew how it went. And we tried to find it online, and there was really no way. So then we thought, okay, we'll make one. So over 7 sessions with aldermen, politicians, professionals, we made an infographic on how it works now. But then we also thought we should make a work canvas to see how we can do it better. And now people at the university in Nijmegen, but also in the municipality, are drawing new ways of how it could be done better. I would like to leave you with 4 questions. In my work I struggle with quite a few things, and I'm wondering also whether you are struggling with these 4 questions as well. And if you are not, I think we should all be struggling with these 4 questions. One is, who are your co's in the co-knowledge production when you are making policy making and research more open? Who really are your co's? It is really hard. Where and with whom you start. Your outcomes really depend on where you start your co-knowledge production. If it is with the system, you're going to find different answers than when it is with the citizens. But where and how to find them is really not that easy. And we're going to find that also out in the workshop this afternoon. We're going to go out in this on the streets and really ask some random people so to experience how difficult and also how easy it sometimes can be. The second one is, do your co's actually really want to work together? I find in my field that most people don't want to work together. We talk a lot about collaboration and amazing system change and how it's all like super easy. It really is not. My work is really about dealing with conflicts every day, every week, trying to get people together, trying to get them to understand each other's lived realities. So yeah, if you have more ideas on how to do this better and quicker and not let me tire me out so much, that would be really great. The third one is we all together really need to understand more about what do your co's normally do, you know? Is it on the left side, working in some sort of prototyping action? Or is it on how to survive the social sector conference? I don't know. Do we work with PowerPoints? Do we work with articles? It's really about the cultures and the artifacts that we work with. And can we change those over the new practices that we are building? So what would this conference look like if we had started this morning by making a podcast together and then present it to one another? Instead of just me standing here with a full audience of knowledge in front of me and only me speaking. So this is really like, what do your co's normally do? And can we build new cultures and artifacts? The last one, do we make use of this? PowerPoints or this? And do they work here or do we work here? The last point. How to support co-knowledge production practices. This is really the one I'm struggling a lot with. It is really, if you really separate real knowledge production from experimental knowledge production, you're gonna run the risk of working on the margins. It is really much more about spreading a mindset and a philosophy, a way of looking at the world, I feel, in order to really support these co-knowledge production practices. And this is really showing in the agendas, the diaries of the policymakers. If you really keep it at an experiment and not make it into something real and sustainable, people are gonna see it as a lab and just like book over their meetings and the diary of the policymaker saying, yeah, whatever, your lab day. You know, like we've got more important things to do. That is really a struggle, and how to really build it from something small and experimental to something real is something that we need to think on a larger scale. So yes, thank you very much. I would like to leave you with a one line from a documentary that I've watched that was really super inspiring. You can find it at www.collaborativesociety.org. And where to start a collaboration? Well, not with the mental parasites in the system where people keep playing their roles. It is really a sort of a statement, but I think it's a good statement to start a discussion with. Thank you very much.